Well, the U.S. declared the official end of combat operations in Iraq last month. The soldiers there say it's a crock, and even if the war doesn't rage on there, it does wage on here. Women and families are disproportionately affected by combat there and also here, regardless of whether the troops are on the ground. A project entitled A Global Crescendo by the International Rescue Committee took our next guest to half a dozen war zones, where she loaned cameras to women who shot scenes illustrating the good and the bad in their lives. She spoke with women who'd seen it all, from victims of mass rape in the Democratic Republic of Congo to Iraqi refugees forced to flee their homeland. The project's been translated into a book, War Is Not Over When It's Over. And we're happy to welcome its author, Anne Jones, journalist, photographer. She's also spent many years working and traveling in Afghanistan. She'll talk about what she learned and why the path we're on now means we could be heading for even darker days. But first, this.
After they raped us, they would walk out, and we would do our best to escape in the bush, and sometimes we would have to crawl on the ground while they would rape others until dawn.
At least 300 civilians were victimized in 13 villages in North Kivu from the 30th of July to the 2nd of August.
In the DRC, sexual violence is not a byproduct of war, but a deliberate tactic. And this means that it is used by armed groups for political, military, and economic advantage. And my conviction is that if it is planned and premeditated tactic, it must be preventable. If women continue to suffer sexual violence during and in the wake of war, it is not because international law is inadequate to protect them, but because it is inadequately enforced.
Anne, thanks for coming in. Because these stories and this topic is still not the headline news it should be, will you just lay it out for our audience again? What's the relationship between sexual violence and combat war?
Sexual violence, as it's used in the Congo and many other places in the world, is designed to break up families, break up communities, stop food production, because women are the ones who produce the food, destroy whole cultures in the process to clear the land so that the guys who are fighting the war can go in freely and get the natural resources that they're fighting over and which they're selling off to the West to finance the war. In the case of the Congo, of course, it's all those ingredients of our computers and cell phones.
You add to the picture, and you always have in your work, with this idea that there's also what we call a domestic scene for war violence. The war violence comes back into the domestic world where it's not called the sexual violence of war anymore.
Well, that's the thing. We talk about this false break between war and peace. And it doesn't work that way for women, because war is a guy thing. And the guys go out and shoot at each other and take the resources. And when they decide to stop shooting at each other, they sit down together and they reach a power-sharing agreement so that everybody gets a little piece of the pie and they collectively retain control of the country. But all the while they're negotiating what they then call peace, they continue to rape and mutilate and torture women and girls. So for women, war is not over when it's over. And in fact, in many of these wars, the violence against women and girls increases when the official peace comes. Because at that point, civilian men catch on to the fact that, hey, these militia guys haven't paid a price for what they've done, so maybe we should start doing it too. And all sides begin to rape.
We have an official end of combat in Iraq. How is this situation playing out here in the U.S. and in Iraq for women?
Well, women in Iraq have been set back probably a century in terms of their rights, their freedom of movement, their access to jobs, health care, all of that. And of course, the rape and violence against women continues. They're threatened and told to stay in their homes.
And here?
And here, as soldiers return from Afghanistan and Iraq, the violence is played out here in dramatically increased rates of child abuse and wife beating and the murder of wives and girlfriends.
You got into this story at birth, basically. You were born into it. What happened?
My father was a war hero. And he was a nice guy before he went to war. And when he came back, of course, he was very changed. I was just a little kid, and I took a lot of the punishment in that family.
And which war was his war?
That was World War I. And at that time, they called it shell shock. It's what we now call PTSD. But it recurs in every war that men come home deeply affected and changed by what they've seen and what they've done.
You interview one gentleman who actually had been liberated by the U.S. invasion, and I don't mean to laugh, but this is part of a story that you think is going to have a happy ending and has the opposite.
Yes, that Ahmed, man I call Ahmed, who was imprisoned by Saddam Hussein as a dissenter and had been in prison for 17 years at the time of the American invasion, which scared off the prison guards, and when the prisoners realized they were gone, they set themselves free. But he had been tortured by Saddam's people, and not long afterwards, he married and then was kidnapped by the Mahdi army and tortured again. And he began to reenact that torture on his own wife, whom he loved very deeply. And the tragedy of this man who couldn't stop himself from almost destroying the person he loved best in the world was heartbreaking.
You have gotten very close to U.S. soldiers, at least in proximity. You chose to be embedded earlier this year with a U.S. unit in Afghanistan, and you wrote the most extraordinarily revealing essay about that for Tom's Dispatch, and we'll link to that on our website. Talk a little bit about that experience and what was in your mind, having spent so much time embedded with the women of Afghanistan for your last book.
Yes, this was my one and only time embedded with the Army, and I had no particular expectations, but it was kind of a shock all the way around. Especially, and soldiers are going to get mad at me for saying this, especially to see how cushy it all was. All the comforts of home, the finest camping I've ever done, but at the same time, of course, surrounded or all of that permeated by the deaths that were occurring every time somebody, some group of soldiers, went outside the wire, because the attacks were ferocious. And I think the principal thing I learned there was that this was no war of counterinsurgency, and the commander of the base told me himself, we're fighting conventional war here. Because there was so much traffic across from Pakistan.
Part of that cushiness is the sense of entitlement and entitlement to protection and separation from harm that the U.S. soldiers feel and expect, very different from the Afghan soldiers, for example, even just what they're wearing. Can you send people to war where they inevitably have that sense of entitlement without it playing out in taking life, as we're seeing in this horrendous hearing of an Afghan, of a U.S. kill team, they call it, or playing out at home in the way that we're documenting, you're documenting with increased violence at home?
I don't know the answer to that, Laura, but I do think it has to be very disconcerting, because it's as though the two sides are fighting in two different centuries. Their methods of warfare are so far apart,
and especially the U.S. and the Afghans.
Yeah, their technological equipment is so far apart, and the Americans ride around in their armored vehicles, and of course the other side has nothing like that. They're busy planting their little bombs.
So it embeds the idea that those lives are worth less than our lives.
It does, but similarly, to the Afghans, it makes the Americans look cowardly. Because why do they have these big machines? Why don't they get out here and fight like men?
So it goes back to, can you send men to war and expect them to come back and live at peace?
I think not, but I think the reason is what we call PTSD, I would describe in many cases as something else, as a sense of deep alienation from our own culture that many of these soldiers come to feel when they're fighting against Afghans and see the poverty in which these people live. And I talked to many soldiers who felt guilty about being sent out to fight against these people. And how can they say that when they come home?
Yeah. Your next book, as I understand it, is going to be about returning soldiers. I'm sure you'll talk about women soldiers there too, and I hope that we can have you back and talk about that before then. The new book is War Is Not Over When It's Over, but I just want to mention that your most classic book, Women Who Kill, has now been recognized as a feminist classic and is being reissued by the Feminist Press. The 30th anniversary of that book?
Yes, and the 40th anniversary of the Feminist Press.
When you reflect on the journey that took you from Women Who Kill to the work now, are you surprised?
I'm not. It feels, well, I am in a way, but it does feel like coming full circle, because I started out exploring questions of violence against women, and now I'm just seeing on a deeper level the relationship between our wars and the militarism of our culture and how that plays out right here at home, in addition to the way it plays out around the world.
Ann Jones's new book is War Is Not Over When It's Over. Women Speak Out from the Ruins of War. It's filled with pictures taken by women in combat zones, some of them called post-combat. Ha. The information and the links to the book are at our website, grittv.org.